Join Charles and Hillary Price as they journey to Iraq and Lebanon to find out how God is at work in the Middle East.
Hello, and welcome to our third special program shot on location in the Middle East. This week, we've returned to Iraq. This country was part of the Ottoman Empire for 500 years until the end of the First World War. It's now a republic, but for many years it was ruled by a series of military dictators, the last one, of course, being Saddam Hussein. But this is still a country that is war-torn. Recently, we've been horrified as extremists have taken over large parts of northern Iraq and targeted religious minorities, including Christians. I'm in the northern part of the country where the Kurdish people are a majority. It's known as Iraqi Kurdistan. Christians have fled here seeking protection and help from local churches. At Living Truth, we know the long-term solution is to bring true peace to this troubled area by the peace that comes with Jesus Christ. But in the short term, we need to help displaced Christians with emergency aid. We want to know if Living Truth can help this small minority in their discipleship and outreach in this community. So join us as we bring you some inspiring stories from a very troubled part of the world.
You are watching a special edition of Living Truth, shot on location in northern Iraq.
I'm in the ancient citadel which dominates the modern city of Erbil. There's a mosque here that is possibly built over a very early church. Today, the Christian church is hanging on in Erbil, but it's struggling. That's why we were delighted to find Pastor Malas and his vibrant church. Let's take a look.
This unassuming office building is the home of the Christian Missionary Alliance Church in Erbil, northern Iraq. Pastor Malath Bethune began with a small house church, but within a month, he had to find a bigger space.
Now, you planted this church. That was 14 months ago. What has accounted for this growth?
I believe it's God. I believe it's only God.
We came here, we believe that God has called us and we have assurance that God wants us to be here in this area. People in this country are so hungry for hope, and we believe the only hope they can find, which is in Jesus Christ. So there is a huge need, not only for our church, but for another 100 churches in this area.
Malath came from a nominal Christian family in Baghdad. During his university years, he committed his life to Christ. It was a difficult time for Christians in Iraq, so he joined an underground church.
Now, you lived in Baghdad. What was it like living under the Saddam Hussein regime?
To live under Saddam Hussein, you have always a sense of fear. You never know what's going to happen. They might capture you anytime, put you in the jail. That means this is the end. So to be a Christian and to do the mission that God has sent us, you know, to do it, evangelize people and try to share the word of God with them, that means a lot. That means you're risking your life.
Malath moved to Erbil from Baghdad to plant the church. There was only one other evangelical church in this city.
If you go back far enough, Iraq, as we know it today, was once a Christian country back in the early centuries. How do you see the future?
As the whole world knows, this area, the Middle East, is on fire. And we believe the only hope for this region is the church. And that's why we are here.
Pastor Malath has mobilized his church to reach out to Syrian refugees.
So these are some of the food parcels that you give away?
Yes.
The Syrians have come to Iraq seeking safety. Each month, 400 families receive one of these food parcels.
No one of them is a Christian family, but we try to help everybody here and telling them this is a church, and the church wants to help you and to stand with you during this hard time.
An hour outside of Erbil is the Kawargosk refugee camp. It shelters mostly Muslim refugees fleeing the civil war in Syria. Malath brings food and encouragement.
We come to the camps and we try to see the needs. We try to see how we can help and how we can show the love of Christ in a practical way. And we practice our faith. This is what we're called to do. And this is a great opportunity for us as a church to share the word of God with them.
Since this interview was filmed, Malath has taken on an even greater burden. Thousands of Iraqi Christians have fled their homes to escape a rapidly advancing extremist army. An entire congregation from Mosul has come to Malath's church seeking food, shelter, and safety. Despite this persecution, the church has hope. God is speaking directly to people through dreams and visions.
When the church hears that Jesus is coming to people through dreams, that means is Jesus telling the church in the Middle East, you are not alone. I'm working beside you. I'm working with you. Never give up. We have seen a lot of, destroyed things and terrorism, bombs, kidnapping, killing, persecution. This is a message that Jesus is telling his church, his bride, never give up. Stand firm and I'm with you and we will continue the work together.
God is also using tools such as satellite TV to speak to people. Even in refugee camps, most people have access to the Word of God through television. A satellite dish is cheap and the signal is free.
Everywhere we look, there are satellite television dishes around the Middle East. What role does media play in communicating the gospel now?
You're really helping every single local church if you do any media program or any Christian television. You can't have a direct access to the people telling them about Jesus Christ or sharing with them about your faith. So with the media, you can enter every single home without even knocking the door. You can even enter their hearts without even asking. And we have seen a lot of people coming to Christ. We have seen a lot of people where their life were changed. They have a church in their rooms with a Christian channel. They worship God through these channels because they can't attend a public church. This is the place where they can receive spiritual food. This is a place when they can receive a comfort. This is a place, when they're watching these programs, they can be built as a Christians. And they can follow Jesus in the right path.
This camp provides only the basic necessities of life, and yet you have satellite dishes all over the camp, including one right next to me on the ground here with a cable that runs through into this tent, and you'll see them over my shoulder here as well. And from these satellite dishes, Al Karma Television is available in this camp free of charge to the people, and that is where we broadcast our Arabic version of Living Truth. We're investing in lives who otherwise would never hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And people sitting in these tents, nobody's monitoring them. They have the freedom to watch and listen and hear. And there are no known Christians in this camp at the moment, but the gospel comes into the airwaves through satellite. So we can broadcast freely over the next few years and see many people come to know Christ.
In many Arabic-speaking parts of the world, the gospel is not easily available. Satellite TV, radio, and the internet can overcome these barriers. Media is the key in today's world to reach people in the Middle East for Christ. And at this difficult time in Iraq, we will help Christian refugees in Erbil with humanitarian aid. We must come alongside the churches of Iraqi Kurdistan as they struggle to accommodate thousands of Christian families who have fled the violence of extremist fighters.
Hillary's interest in women and their spiritual journeys led her to Mama Hanan. Hanan was raised in an Egyptian family that had immigrated to Africa. From early childhood, she struggled with the role of women in her culture and in her religion.
Tell me about where you were born and just a little bit of your upbringing, what it was like for you.
I was born in Sudan, but girls did not have a voice. Could be abused in different way in the name of the religion and the society. And also as a female, you're half of the man. Everything outside on the street in this society you do is a shame.
Hanan searched for her identity in the religion of her birth. But the more she searched, the more she rejected the way her faith treated women.
So I think as a woman, I got offended, especially as a young girl. So I chose to study psychology to help me to understand my identity as a female or as a girl in that society. Because there was a big contradiction between the family brought me up and the society.
Hanan's studies in psychology took her to Egypt, where she became interested in women's rights. It was here she encountered Christians for the first time.
The people who have Christian faith, they are honest. You can feel safe with them. So my experience with them is different. And I start to question why the Christians are different. And then somebody said, because their books say love, peace, and forgiveness. I think those are the three words. So I wanted to know that. Because I didn't experience that in my faith.
A woman friend took Hanan to Kasr el Dabara, a large evangelical church in Cairo. Conversion from the religion of her birth to Christianity was illegal in Egypt. Consequently, she attracted the interest of the Egyptian government for both her work in women's rights and her interest in Christianity.
Between all this, I got prosecuted in Egypt because all these things are against the government, and they took my passport. So I went to the United Nations. They recognized me as a refugee, and then I can go to another country for asylum. So the choice was Canada.
And what happened when you got to Canada?
Of course, I had a faith, and I know that where people go to, but now I decided not to follow that faith because I couldn't find myself there. And I couldn't also reach God there. It was so scary for me. So I decided just to close that door and run away.
Hanan was lost in a foreign country, struggling to find her identity. But she continued to search for God in Christianity.
So then a time came when you personally responded to Jesus. So how did that happen?
One day I was questioning, like, who are you? What are you going to do to me? Are you going to solve all my problems that I have? And how am I going to deal with this? I just hear this voice, just invite me to your life. Just bring me in. And I said, okay, I invite you. And then what is next?
Attending a church was too difficult for Hanan, so she turned to Christian TV to learn more about her new faith. She found living truth. It was the message about Hagar, the servant girl, who had a son by Abraham, that spoke directly to her.
That teaching was exactly talking about me. I was like abused, but the society approved that. She was just a maid, like, you can get a son from her. And she was not honored for anything, and that, yeah, misused, and she was so confused. She didn't know why that happened to her, and she was kicked out, and she was running away. She ran away, and God met her at that time. And he talked to her. He recognized her, he acknowledged her, and though she was rejected without doing anything, which has given me comfort that my people are still can be honored by God, and I am honored by God like Hagar.
And he called her by name, didn't he?
He did.
Rather than just a slave girl, she's Hagar. She sees the God who sees her, so.
Yes.
So from what you've said, then the watching of Living Truth has been pivotal in your understanding, your development, your relationship. Is that still a part of your life?
It is. I believe having Arabic program or a Middle East is an answer of prayer. That's exactly what we need in the Middle East. There's so many people and the satellites is everywhere. People have access to the media. And of course, the internet and everything. But they need this kind of teaching, which have, like, it's go break into their minds, whether they're male or female, and it has that revelation the from the Bible.
Today, Hanan is still working out her identity as a woman of Christ. She hopes that other women and men in the Middle East will be able to watch Living Truth in Arabic and know that God calls them also by name.
You are watching For the Kingdom of God, Living Truth in the Middle East.
In many parts of the Middle East, it's difficult to be a Christian. It's especially difficult in Saudi Arabia, where it's illegal to change from one religion to another. Recently, in Toronto, I met a woman from Saudi Arabia who has been through tremendous struggles because she decided to become a Christian. Even though she now lives in Canada, she still fears reprisals. So we've concealed her identity. We'll call her Layla, and we're grateful to her for being willing to tell her story so we can understand what our brothers and sisters in Christ endure in other parts of the world. So Layla, tell me a little bit about where you grew up as a child.
I grew up in Saudi Arabia. My life there was so horrible when I was a child. They always think about women, she weak, she can't do anything. My family, they are very extremely religious. Sometimes when I was a child, I preferred to grow up boy because I see my father, how he preferred the boy than all my sisters.
In Saudi Arabia, it is common for girls to get married at 15 or 16. At an even younger age, they must cover themselves when they go out of the house.
I remember my mom, when I was 10 years, she asked me to cover all my body to wear name abaya, which is a black dress, and the woman also to cover her face.
And what sort of education did you have growing up?
I told my father I want to finish university. He told me, enough for you. Why you want to finish university? It is enough for you, you finish high school, because you still at home, we find you the right mind to get married.
So how did you persuade your father to let you go to university?
I speak with him many times. I told him, I want to go to university, this is my dream, and I want to be a nurse. But he told me, nurse, it is not good for you, because if you work nurse, you work with man. Then I changed my dream, and he chose for me to be teacher.
You changed your dream?
Yeah.
Layla began to study at university, but her life was about to get a lot worse.
First year in university, it was horrible, because somebody come and ask my father he want to marry me. And I told my father, and I want to finish my study first. After that, I thinking about marriage. He said, no, if you refuse this man, nobody will come to marry you, and it's a big problem. My family pushed me to do it, and after 6 months, I get just divorced because it was the wrong man for me. Because he just told me, you are nobody, you just stay at home. You don't need to continue to study.
She returned to university. After she got her degree, she was not allowed to work. But ironically, her enforced time at home exposed her to some new ideas.
Because I am a woman, I stay at home, and the most of the time I don't have anything to do, just watch TV. One time, I remember it was Christian holiday. I just changed the station, and I saw this channel, and I stopped, and I just watched what's going on. Then I feel something in my heart, something changed. And I want to know more, but I cannot watch it every time because, you know, inside the home control from my parents, what do you watch on TV? Because in satellites, you can watch anything. One time I was very stressful and I stopped in this channel and I watched it. Then I started praying with him and I feel something in my heart, like something come for me. They make me open my eyes about Christianity. And I try to read about Christianity, but I cannot read anything because internet is controlled by government. We cannot have any book for other religion to read. But I was so interested to know more about Christianity.
When a friend left Saudi Arabia to study abroad, Layla begged her father to do the same. After 3 years, he finally allowed her to leave, but only if she was accompanied by her younger brother.
So what happened when you and your brother arrived in Canada?
When I arrived in Canada, it was for me so shocked because I feel like I am in a different world. And I see the people, how they are so nice with me and friendly, and they smile to me. And I have wrong idea about those country. When I come to Canada, I feel freedom for me. I can meet the people to see how they pray for God and to learn more about Christianity.
With her newfound freedom, Layla got an Arabic Bible, and she continued her search on television.
Raised again to walk in newness of life.
One time I see the shares on TV, and it was living through. And I love when the preacher speaks.
Mm-hmm.
He speaks clearly, and I understand what he says.
A friend brought her to People's Church, and she discovered the preacher was Charles Price, the same man she had seen on television.
I love this place. I want to be a Christian, but I don't know who to speak or how to start.
Layla began to attend weekly classes where she learned how to become a Christian. Then came her big decision.
I do baptize in People's Church, and it was so wonderful day for me. I feel like the Spirit come inside my body, and I receive the Holy Spirit from Jesus. And thank you to God.
What difference does it make for you to be a Christian?
It is a big difference. Because before my life was horrible. But now I am a Christian, I am so happy. I feel I am free. All my life changed for better.
And how about now we're doing an interview? Is that fearful for you? Is this a difficult thing for you to be doing?
It is so difficult because I am from Saudi Arabia. If the people know, they try to kill me because I changed my religion to Christianity. And it is difficult for me to go back to Saudi Arabia.
Layla cannot go back to Saudi Arabia to tell her sisters about her faith in Christ. And the laws in Saudi Arabia against conversion and evangelism make access to information about Christianity very restricted. Satellite TV is the only way to break through these barriers.
I think that television is very important in Middle East because usually the woman, she's still at home. They don't have anything to do, just watch TV. Satellites help many people to know about Christianity. I hope this helps people to open the eyes. and open their heart to know about God and about Christianity.
Media is currently playing a vital role in the spiritual awakening of many people in the Middle East. Media is especially important to women, who are often confined to their homes without the freedom to go out unaccompanied. By watching television in the privacy of their own homes, many are turning to Christian programs and hearing the gospel for themselves by that means. Young people are on the internet in the privacy of their homes and finding sites that discuss the gospel. They connect on Facebook, they explore YouTube, and they Google the information they are seeking, just like in the West. Satellite television is almost 100% coverage in the Middle East, and the internet is fast becoming universally available. The technology is accessible as never before to deliver the message of the gospel. Living Truth is broadcasting in Arabic on satellite TV. We're already bringing Bible teaching to the Middle East, and indeed to Arabic-speaking people all around the world. Now we want to strengthen our Arabic ministry with a website that people can access, with radio broadcasts, with our daily devotional in Arabic, and materials for churches and Bible study groups. People want hope, and we know that hope and deep inner peace is available to those who find Jesus Christ. I've enjoyed meeting with Pastor Malas of the Christian and Missionary Alliance. It's exciting to see a new, young, vibrant church that puts missions, evangelism, and outreach at the top of its agenda. On Sunday, he invited me to speak in the church that meets in the building behind me, and I spoke from John chapter 11 on the story of Jesus raising Lazarus from the dead, a picture of coming alive spiritually. Well, thank you, Pastor Malas, very, very much. I'm going to read to you from John's Gospel in chapter 11. Chapter 11 and verse 1. Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. And then down to verse 17. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. And then to verse 38. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there'll be a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you've sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes, loose him, and let him go. Lazarus had a problem. It was a very simple, straightforward problem.
وكانت هذه المشكلة ممكن نعبر عنها ببساطة وبشكل واضح ونقول إنه المشكلة.
He was dead.
إنه المشكلة إنه العازر كان ميت.
That's the only problem he had.
المشكلة الوحيدة اللي العازر إنه كان ميت.
But it's a pretty serious problem to have.
لكنه هذه مشكلة خطيرة جدا.
He may have been a clever man. That didn't matter when he was dead.
ممكن يكون العازر هو شخص ذكي لكن هو لما عنده مشكلة إنه هو ميت.
He may have been very gifted. That didn't matter when he was dead. You see, death cancelled out everything else that may have been right about him. You know, there are lots of people around who only have one problem. They're dead. Not physically. They're walking around on the streets of Erbil tonight. You meet them on the street, you meet them in your place of work. You might even meet them in church.
وممكن ايضا انه تقابلهم بالكنيسة.
You see, the Bible talks about there being more than simply physical life and physical death.
انه الكتاب المقدس يتكلم كانه اكو اكثر من مجرد حياة جسدية, حياة جسمانية.
Jesus once spoke to a group of healthy living people.
يسوع كان يتكلم إلى ناس أصحاء جسديا.
And he said to them, I have come that you might have life.
يسوع كان يتكلم إلى ناس أصحاء وأحياء وكان يقول لهم أنا قد جئت لكي تكون لكم حياة.
And they may have thought, but we're alive.
ويمكن هم فكروا وقالوا بس إحنا أحياء.
Yes, your body is alive.
نعم ممكن يكون أنت جسديا حي.
You can think and feel and decide.
ممكن أنت تكون تشعر تحس تفكر تقرر.
But there's something more important than your body.
لكن هناك جزء مهم أكثر من مجرد جسدك الخارجي.
And that is your spirit.
وهو روحك.
And your spirit is the area in which you're designed to know and experience God Himself.
وروحك هو المكان الذي صمم وصنع من قبل الله لكي يختبر معرفة الله ويختبر حياة الله وحضور الله.
And that's a fundamental problem that most people have in the world tonight.
وهذه هي المشكلة الأساسية التي يعاني منها جميع الناس وأغلب الناس في هذا العالم.
Physically alive and healthy.
جسدياً أصحاء ونشطين و.
Mentally, socially, soulishly alive.
وعقلياً واجتماعياً وفي العلاقات.
But they're spiritually dead.
لكنهم روحياً ميتين.
And being dead cancels out everything else that may seem to be right.
وأنه تكون ميت أن يكون الإنسان ميت روحياً يلغي كل الامتيازات الأخرى الجسدية والنفسية والذهنية.
Let me just point out a few basic symptoms of being dead.
خلينا نتعرض إلى بعض مظاهر الموت الروحي.
A dead man doesn't eat.
الإنسان الميت ما يأكل.
He has no appetite.
أصلاً ما عنده شهية للأكل.
Nobody said, well, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days, take him a kebab. Give him a glass of milk. He wouldn't be interested. He has no appetite. And you know, there are many people around this building tonight who are not in this place of worship for one simple reason, they have no appetite.
ونحن نعرف إنه كثير من الناس حولنا في هذه المنطقة اللي إحنا عايشين فيها هم مو موجودين الآن في محضر الرب في العبادة والتسبيح ببساطة لأن ماكو شوق لعبادة الله.
You say you want a good evening.
تقول إنه تريد يعني تكون عندك مساء جيد.
And come to our church.
تعال إلى الكنيسة.
Oh no, that's the most boring thing I could think of.
يقول لك يعني الكنيسة هذا أمل مكان ممكن إنه أسمع به.
No appetite.
ماكو شهية وشوق إلى الله.
And you know, when God begins to work in a person's heart, one of the first evidences is that He awakens an appetite within our hearts.
وأول شيء عمل الله في حياة الشخص في قلب الإنسان هو أن يضع فيه شوق وشهية للأمور الروحية.
You know, a baby in a womb is being fed.
جنين في بطن أمه قبل الولادة هو يتغذى.
And sometimes a person begins to sense a stirring within their soul. I want to find what life is about. I want to discover if God can be known. And that appetite can be aroused in any human being. And maybe you're here tonight and you're here because you sense this in your own heart, an appetite to seek after God. You know, a dead man doesn't eat, but a dead man doesn't learn very much. No one took Lazarus the latest news.
يعني ما حد راح للعازر قال له العازر تعال اسمعك العاجل اخير الاخبار يعني.
Lazarus, Bethany beat Jerusalem 6-4 in soccer.
انه يقول له يابا تعال يا العازر ترى فريق اورشليم فاز على فريق بيت لحم 6-0 6-2.
Lazarus wouldn't be interested.
لانه العازر ما راح يكون يعني مهتم بالموضوع.
See, a dead man doesn't need food.
لهذا انه الشخص الميت لا ياكل طعام.
A dead man doesn't need education.
والشخص الميت لا يحتاج الى معرفه وتثقيف.
There's only one thing a dead man needs.
الشخص الميت يحتاج شيء واحد.
He needs life.
يحتاج الى حياه.
Once he has life, he'll have an appetite, he'll have curiosity.
مجرد انه ياخذ الحياه ويبدي انه قلبه ينبض بالحياه، هذا الشخص راح يكون عنده شهيه، راح يكون عنده اشواق.
Now the sisters of Lazarus, Martha and Mary, did a very wise thing.
خوات العازر مرثا ومريم عملوا شيء حكيم.
They sent for Jesus.
أرسلوا في طلب يسوع.
He was only sick. Lazarus was only sick at this point.
في المرحلة اللي كان فيها العازر لا يزال العازر مريض.
And Jesus delayed his coming.
ويسوع أخر قدومه إلى بيت عنيا إلى مكان اللي فيه العازر.
So when he arrived, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days.
حتى يعني بشكل متعمد حتى ما يسوع لما يوصل لبيت عنيا يكون العازر ميت.
Not only dead but sealed in the tomb.
لكن مو فقط ميت لكنه هو موضوع في القبر.
And when Jesus came into Bethany, Martha ran to meet him.
مجرد أنه دخل يسوع إلى بيت عنيا ركضت إليه مرثا.
And verse 21 says, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died.
وفي الآية 11 تقول مرثا يا سيد لو كنت ها هنا لما مات أخي.
Now notice, she's talking only in the past tense.
تذكر أنه هي تقول يا سيد فقط لو كنت في الماضي.
If only you had been here 4 days ago.
يعني كأنه تقول له انتبه الكلام كله في فعل الماضي لو كنت هنا قبل 4 أيام.
But now it's too late.
لكن الآن كأنه يرى بس الوقت صار متأخر.
And I'm helpless and I'm hopeless.
أنا داشر بالتعب داشر باليأس.
Do you ever think that?
هل أنت تفكر بتعتقد هذا الشيء؟
If only when I was younger. I had let Jesus do something in my life, but it's too late now. People think that way.
الناس يفكرون بهذه الطريقة.
Maybe somebody here tonight does.
ممكن إنه بعض الناس يفكرون ويشعرون بهذا الشعور.
Well, Jesus said to her then in verse 23.
لكن يسوع قال لها في الآية 23.
Your brother will rise again.
قال لها يسوع سيقوم أخوك.
And Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day.
قالت له مرثا أنا أعلم إنه سيقوم في القيامة في اليوم الأخير.
Notice now she's speaking in the future tense.
في البداية كانت تتكلم في الماضي لكن لاحظ هسه بدها تتكلم في المستقبل.
And you know we can think about the work of God in our lives if only in the past, well one day in the future.
إنه مرات احنا نفكر بعمل الله، مرات نفكر بعمل الله في الماضي، الله نفسره في الماضي، مرات فقط في المستقبل.
But you know what Jesus said to Martha?
لكن انتبه ماذا قال ليسوع، قال يسوع لمرثا.
In verse 25.
في الآية 25.
I can imagine he looked her right in the eye.
أنا أتصور أن يسوع نظر إلى عيون مرثا بشكل مباشر.
And said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he died.
وقال لها يسوع أنا هو القيامة والحياة من آمن بي ولو مات فسيحيا.
Jesus spoke only in the present tense.
يسوع كان كلامه في الحاضر.
What do you need?
ماذا تحتاج؟
Resurrection?
القيامة.
I am the resurrection.
هل يحتاج قيامة؟ أنا هو القيامة.
You need life?
هل يحتاج إلى حياة؟
I am the life.
أنا هو الحياة.
If you look very carefully, you'll see that Jesus spoke again and again in the present tense about himself.
لو لاحظت وقرأت بتمعن سوف تلاحظ أن يسوع كان يتكلم بصيغة الحاضر مرة ومرة. I am, أنا هو يقول, أنا هو.
To those who are lost, I am the way.
لهؤلاء الذين هم ضائعين وضالين, أنا هو الطريق.
To those who are confused, I am the truth.
لهؤلاء الذين هم مشوشين, أنا هو الحق.
To those who feel in darkness, I am the light of the world. To those who are hungry, I am the bread of life. To those who feel on the outside, I am the door. And to those who are dead, I am the life. Our message is not Christianity.
رسالتنا هي ليست عن الديانة المسيحية.
Our message is Christ.
رسالتنا عن شخص المسيح.
a living person who alone can and will meet the deepest needs of the human heart. And it's not just that he gives us life. He is the life that he gives. John wrote in the New Testament, he that has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. Because this life is in the Son. It is the life of the Son himself, Jesus Christ, who comes to live within us. And makes us alive with his life. I talked to somebody yesterday. He said, I love Jesus. I believe in Jesus. But he is a prophet. Not the Son of God. And I said, but a prophet says, go here, go there. He said, I agree. I said, but Jesus did not say that. He said, come to me. No prophet says that. He didn't say, I'll show you the way, I am the way. And so he says to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. And then he made it personal for Martha. He said in verse 26, do you believe this? Now this is a personal question that requires a personal response. It's not just, is this true? But do you believe this? And in verse 27, yes, Lord, she told him, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God who has come into the world. Well, notice what happened when she said, yes, Lord, I believe. In verse 39, Jesus must have shocked Martha. He said, take away the stone. Now, if you believe this, Martha, it's not just an intellectual thing. You have to do something. Take away the stone. What does that mean? Expose the problem. The condition of your heart. The need that you have. And suddenly Martha wasn't quite sure if she believed or not. Because it says, but Lord, said Martha, by this time there is a bad smell, for he's been there for 4 days. Expose the need within your own heart and life. Uh-oh. That smells. And of course, in your heart and my heart, there are things that smell. And maybe there might be some of us here who say, I would love to know Jesus, but there is so many things wrong in my life. And maybe there's one big ugly thing there and it stinks. Maybe something you say, no, I'm going to keep the stone on the front of this grave.
لا, لا, لن أرفع الحجر.
That's why Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you in verse 40, if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" Meaning, if you really believe, you will see God do something which is beyond anything that's natural or even feasible to you.
وقال لها يسوع ألم أقل إنك إن آمنتي بالحقيقة الإيمان الحقيقي سوف ترين الله يصنع شيء يفوق الوصف والخيال شيء معين يصنعه الله بطريقة معجزية.
She might have said, "We tried to keep Lazarus alive." We gave him medicines. Nothing has worked. Maybe you've battled with things in your life and nothing has worked. This is not about something working. If you believed, said Jesus, you will see God do something, not something working. God himself is bigger than death, bigger than the problem, bigger than the issue, bigger than the smell.
يسوع نفسه الله نفسه هو اقوى من الموت اقوى من النتانة اقوى من اليأس اقوى من كل هذه الاشياء.
Verse 41 says, "So she took away the stone." That must have taken courage, but you have to do it.
لكن لابد انه تفعل ان يكون عندك الشجاعه وترفع الحجر.
Not sit back and say, "Well, make him come alive then." There are always things that God asks us to do that we must do because we believe that the end result is going to be that God is going to do something.
هناك دائما الله يطلب شيء من الناس لكي بالنهاية يكون عمل الله المعجزي في تداخل عظيم.
So they rolled away the stone.
ورفعوا الحجر.
Probably a big smell came out to the
وممكن انه لما
door.
رفعوا الحجر يعني فاحت الريحة.
And then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you've heard me."
ويسوع قال رفع عينيه الى فوق وقال ايها الاب اشكرك لانك سمعت لي.
When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out."
فلما قال هذا صرخ يسوع بصوت عظيم لعازر هلما خارجا.
He didn't speak about the deadness.
ولم يتكلم عن الموت.
He spoke to the deadness.
لكنه تكلم إلى الموت.
Come out, come alive.
تكلم إلى هذا الميت اللي مليان موت. تعال هلما خارجا اخرج للحياة.
And when God speaks into a situation, when Jesus Christ speaks into a situation, there is power that is life-giving power in his word.
ولما الله يتكلم إلى موقف لما يسوع يتكلم إلى موقف هناك السلطان وقوة تخرج من فم الرب تحيي الموقف وتصنع معجزة.
When he speaks into your heart and my heart, into your sin and to my sin, when he speaks, there's power and life in his word.
ولما يتكلم يسوع إلى قلبي وقلبك إلى حالتي وحالتك هناك سلطان وهناك قوة تخرج من الرب تتوجه إلى قلوبنا وتحيينا.
And Lazarus came alive.
قام وصار له حياة مرة أخرى.
But you know, he didn't simply say, "Lazarus, wake up."
لكنه مو فقط قال إنه يعني لعازر انهض من بين الأموات.
He said, "Lazarus, come out."
لكن ما قال فقط لعازر انهض من بين الأموات، لكن قال لعازر هلما خارجا تعال اطلع.
When he received life and he heard the voice of Jesus.
لما أخذ الحياة وسمع صوت الرب يسوع المسيح.
He had to do something.
أيضا لعازر كان لابد أن يفعل شيء.
Don't just lie there alive in the tomb. Come out.
لكن الرب قال له مو فقط إنه أنا أقول لك انهض وتبقى في مكانك، لكن انهض واخرج من القبر.
And it says, and Lazarus came out.
لعازر هلما خارجا.
The dead man came out, says verse 44. There's a combination of things here. There is believing. There is God acting. And there's Lazarus obeying. And there's that in your life and mine. Do you believe?
هل تؤمن؟
Then expose the situation to him.
إذا كنت تؤمن فاكشف قلبك اعترف.
And say thank you that you hear me.
وتقول له يا رب أشكرك لأنك سمعتني.
Thank you can transform that deadness in my life and bring life. And then it's coming out. There's being willing then to say, I have been born again of the Spirit of God. I'm coming out of this tomb where it's a home for death, not for life. And standing outside the tomb, he was alive, but he looked dead because he was still in the grave clothes. And he needed to be released and let go. God's purpose is we receive a salvation that we thoroughly enjoy. A salvation that is free from all the trappings of the old life. Well, Lazarus would be free to run and skip and jump down the road. I love the language, loose him and let him go. It's like holding an arrow in a bow. Full stretch. Loose it and let it go. And God's purpose is not just that we receive life, but we enjoy that life. And we're bold to believe we are free. I don't have to live the way I lived. I can live a new life. It is life more abundant. It might get us into trouble. In the next chapter, they wanted to kill Lazarus. It's embarrassing to other people sometimes when somebody comes alive. And but this is God's purpose for you, for me, for all of us. And I ask you as I finish, where are you in this story tonight? Are you dead? But there's a stirring in your soul, you want to live? Then you need to reach out to Jesus. Because he's reaching to you. Believe him. Trust him. Thank him that he hears you. Say, Lord, cleanse me and give me life. Maybe you are alive. But you're bound in the grave clothes. Maybe that's where you are. Jesus didn't finish the work simply with making him alive. Loose him and let him go. Other people had to help him to do that, and that's why we meet together with other believers like this. We help each other to be free and live. Or maybe you're alive and loosed. That is God's purpose for each of us. We've had a wonderful series of programs over these past 3 weeks that show how God is at work in this troubled part of the world. Despite difficulties, Christians are serving God and sharing Christ with other people. We've seen the powerful influence of the media
and the need for Christ-centered Bible teaching. Millions of people watch satellite television. That's why a television ministry is so effective here. People who would be afraid to go to a church can access information about Christ in the privacy of their own homes. We met Majid, who told us that media played a key role in his journey to Christ. Ashti explained she turned to Christian satellite programs during a very dark time in her life, and those programs drove her to read the scriptures for herself. Then there was Halil from Arab World Media, who told us how people are coming to their website to find out about Christ. We visited the Cedar Home Orphanage and met 15 girls who have all heard the gospel, some of them for the first time. At Christ Evangelical Baptist, we spoke with Pastor Michel about what he called a revival happening in Beirut. And we saw how local pastors and church leaders need training and encouragement at the prayer conference in Erbil. I hope you've enjoyed the journey over the past 3 weeks as we've been in Iraqi Kurdistan and Lebanon. If you want to watch these programs again or share them with your friends, they can be seen on our website. Just click on Video On Demand. Next week, we'll be back to our regular Living Truth program, so I look forward to seeing you then. For now, goodbye and God bless you.